I'm old enough to remember payphone freaking and learning about blue boxes and red boxes and stuff like that. I remember there being a time where you could take a paper clip, stretch it out, touch it to a part of the payphone's receiver, microphone piece, touch it to a part of the payphone and make free phone calls. I was in junior high school, it was a great party trick. My buddy and I would log into BBS systems, read old editions of the 2600 e-newsletters, learn about people like Captain Crunch, groups like Legion of Doom. It was all very exciting for a couple of suburban teenagers who obviously didn't get out too much. We never got much farther than getting our hands on a few underground publications, a handful of long-distance calling card numbers, and some basic programming hacks, customizing error messages and such. So I may have a tiny more perspective as to hacking than some, but the layperson might think a conference about hacking might only conjure images of computer coding and Scorpion or Mr. Robot. While topics along these lines are prevalent here, what I like about the hacking mentality that I've heard a lot about is that it encompasses a broad category of activity, or looking at or accomplishing things in unexpected ways. I suppose one can call most of invention some form of hacking, taking information and materials that existed previously, combining or manipulating them into new ways or a new thing or a new process, or go deeper, a new philosophy. To some extent, I think that's true, that all things are hacks of other things. But to embody the true spirit of hacking, I think there needs to be an element of badassery, doing something truly unexpected or unintended, breaking free of the idea that you're not supposed to do that. This might mean, of course, something illegal, but as many would also agree, sometimes legality and morality clash, something we've heard a lot of the sessions here talk about. So when I think of people who are able to infiltrate systems and create long-lasting, important legacies that include science and technology, and doing so in a way that was difficult, if not nearly impossible, and surely unexpected at the time, I think back to African-American pioneers who, in the early days of the Republic, against many odds, were somehow able to make an indelible mark on history with their invaluable contributions. For instance, among many other important scientific works, Benjamin Banneker wrote a series of almanacs from 1792 to 1797 that would revolutionize the genre, as it were. They contain astronomical calculations, eclipses and tides, and all the almanac-y things. In the late 1880s, Granville Woods invented the induction telegraph, which allowed people to communicate back and forth via voice over telegraph wires. This was used, for example, to help avoid train accidents and such. In some ways, Granville Woods invented the makings of the telephone and the walkie-talkie, things like that. Louis Latimer helped Alexander Graham Bell patent the telephone. He himself holds several patents, including for the electric lamp and the process for manufacturing carbons, the filaments used to light incandescent bulbs. He then went on to improve the work being done by some dude named Thomas Edison. Dr. Charles Drew developed methods to process and store blood plasma and organize the world's first blood mobiles and blood banks. Garrett Morgan patented the three-way traffic light. Previously, traffic signals just said stop and go, had a little stick. African-American women have also been great innovators, of course. We all pretty much know about Harriet Tubman, but not certainly to the extent that matches her great deeds. Madam C.J. Walker, a businesswoman in the hair care field, invented a hot comb or a straightening comb that would help her go on to become, by some accounts, the first African-American millionaireess. Some of these people were able to achieve these great things through the help of education, but you also had folks like Latimer who had no formal training or scientific schooling at all. Yet all of them were incredibly valuable to our nation's history: engineering, technology, social justice, entrepreneurship. Now, many may not have heard of some of these people. Many young people, school-aged people, haven't heard of many of these people. Despite being the son of a brilliant sociologist, attending a decent school in a well-integrated community, when I was a teenager, I didn't know much about the contributions of many African Americans in the past. Neither did many of my peers, many of them African American themselves. Then in 1989.
Sure. What we do, right?
Stupid, what needs to be taught? Because black and white kids both take shorts. When one doesn't know about the other one's culture, ignorance swoops down like a vulture. Because you don't know that you ain't just a janitor. No one told you about Benjamin Banneker, a brilliant black man that invented the almanac. Can't you see what KRS is coming at? With Eli Whitney, Haile Selassie, Graham Bill Woods made the walkie-talkie. Louis Latimer improved on Edison. Charles Drew did a lot for medicine. Garrett Morgan made the traffic lights. Harriet Tubman freed the slaves at night. Madam C.J. Walker made the straightening comb. But you won't know this if you weren't shown. The point I'm getting at, it might be harsh, is we're just walking around brainwashed. See what I'm saying? It's not to diss a man. We need the 89 school system, one that caters to a black return, because you must learn.
Karis One, song called You Must Learn, a rap song detailing some of the accomplishments of African-American inventors and innovators, many of whom are largely unknown or unheralded when young people study the pantheon of American industrial and scientific folklore. Among all the myriad ways this country has insidiously worked really, really hard to discount, discredit, and disown the efforts of minorities, silencing the ones who have made incredible impact on our nation's prosperity is particularly harmful, as it denies generations of people of color the idea that they have been as important to our growth as anyone. Representation matters, and hip-hop found a way to deliver that message to young people. Disclaimer, KRS-One did take some liberties with a couple of facts in the song. Banneker didn't invent the almanac, he'd greatly advanced it. Somehow the idea that Eli Whitney, who invented the cotton gin, was African-American made that way into the song. But to be fair, there's a lot of people who swear they were taught something along those lines. There's some confusion happening there, Mandela syndrome effect or whatever. But if nothing else, KRS-One's lyrics open the eyes of a generation of rap fans to some badass African-American innovators who they damn sure weren't taught much about at all. Now, fans of rap music may notice that during that particular time period that KRS was out, there were many examples of rap that delved into the ideas of black pride and racial injustice. Groups like Public Enemy, of course, Brand Nubian, Poor Righteous Teachers, all spoke loudly and proudly about the existence of black excellence and the concerted efforts of an oppressive society to squelch those stories. And then in the years that passed, for whatever reason, these types of artists and songs dwindled from the mainstream. Now, much could be debated about whether or not this was a purposeful thing, a corporate-led coup against the free speech of rap music when that music was too informative, and when hip-hop community started to look like it might become a constituency. It's a complicated conspiracy theory, but I'm sure that certain powers that be didn't want that kind of direct messaging to be prominent. They were okay with rapper's delight and fun party rap, you know. Hip-hop wasn't having it. Now, to me, someone who had been enveloped with music and culture of hip-hop for most of my life, this strikes me as an illustration of how hip-hop found a way to hack the system of education and activism, right under the noses of a population who thought they were only getting a passing fad of modern-day minstrel music. The spirit of this continues, even though the airwaves have long since capitulated to music that works better in a strip club than in a thoughtful cipher among young people of color, using the arts to help motivate them to address and possibly attack the forces that are working against them in their communities and across the country. Here's an example. In October 2016, a 35-year-old man died in Las Vegas. A week later, a memorial event at an iconic New York City performance venue, not far from here, overflowed with people paying tribute to this man. Among other things, he was a musician, songwriter, recording artist, and activist. Those who spoke in his honor included other activists, some who had worked alongside him to combat human rights violations in places like Cuba and Palestine. Others were members of Justice League NYC and Cop Watch, New York-based organizations he had partnered with to help address police brutality and discriminatory law enforcement practices. Many in attendance were musical comrades, including a group of rap artists who pledged to continue the public performance series that he founded, which entertains tens of thousands of people every year at no cost, right outside Friday night, Union Square, subway station. You see them called Legendary Cyphers. They're out there every Friday. This man's disdain for injustice came out through his music, but also through his actions. He invited civil justice reform organizations into album release parties. He marched the New York City streets, standing arm in arm with other protests and artists, in response to the death of Eric Garner, the Staten Island man who died while being forcibly apprehended by members of the NYPD. He contacted organizations on the ground in Ferguson, Missouri, to coordinate New York-based protests in response to the police killing of Michael Brown. In all, dozens of people from various disciplines and walks of life spoke emotionally about the positive impact this man had made on their personal and professional lives. That man's name was Daniel Majesty Sanchez, and he touched all these lives through hip-hop. Majesty is one of countless important, relevant, and heartfelt hip-hop-related stories from around the world that go untold. There were no major media outlets covering his memorial, hip-hop or otherwise. There were no mainstream rap superstars paying homage. There were no radio station tributes, despite him being from the city where once influential radio station Hot 97 still purports to be where hip-hop lives. Yet to many, Majesty personified hip-hop. He's one of the first people I think of when I hear people decry the substance, the lack of talent, authenticity, or activism in today's hip-hop. He quickly comes to mind when those are unfamiliar with the genre's depth, degraded, scoffing at the notion that it could be anything more than misogynistic, vice-riddled, self-destructive drivel, as they've been often led to believe. And these things do exist in hip-hop. But knowing what Majesty and so many others across multiple disciplines have been able to accomplish using hip-hop, music, culture, and spirit, it's worth considering, and as much as it's influenced music, radio, popular culture, fashion, advertising, to create industries and benefit commerce, can hip-hop influence other areas such as education, healthcare, technology, politics, entrepreneurship, fine arts, urban planning, spirituality, in ways that could benefit the citizens of the nation that birthed it? The answer is already a resounding yes. I started to understand this many years ago as founder and editor-in-chief of Birthplace Magazine, which I created to help document hip-hop music and culture in and around New York City. While covering local musicians, lyricists, DJs, and producers, I also became aware of people and organizations who were applying hip-hop in different, innovative ways. Many who had been practicing hip-hop intersectionality for years, connecting the music and the culture to fields like education, social work, counseling, community organizing, science and technology, and the fine arts. It became increasingly apparent to me how influential hip-hop was becoming in these other, sometimes wholly unexpected fields. It was also striking how news of these innovations was often shrouded from the general public. Surprisingly, even those who considered themselves part of hip-hop or connected to hip-hop were largely unaware that the beloved music and culture were being used to improve lives and communities. And the specifics were inspiring. After being introduced to hip-hop-based learning methodology, students were passing previously failed exams at an astounding rate of success, upwards of 80% or better, according to Fresh Prep, a New York City-based test prep program that teaches high school-level material through music and lyrics. Another company, Flocabulary, assembles and sells curriculum packages covering dozens of subjects, including songs, videos, and other materials that reflect the style, language, and swagger that young people relate to, with similar success. Now, is this not hacking, right? Recognizing flaws and vulnerabilities in the public education system and creating, without permission, without going through the proper channels, an alternative access point and establishing a jerry-rigged solution to a problem that the establishment was ignoring or at the very least had proven it couldn't solve. This lies at the very core of what hip-hop is. Since its beginning, hip-hop has been using pre-existing resources in absurdly unexpected ways to create not only a new genre, but an entire culture built out of rubble and despair. The Bronx in the early 1970s were desolate in terms of resources. Poor communities riddled with violence, stripped of opportunity, and robbed of support. It was a wild, wild East. Arts and recreation programs had disappeared. Hell, police and firemen had disappeared. The Bronx, as folks might remember, was literally burning to the ground. Yet amid the chaos and hostility, groups of young people began to craft their own form of art, music, their own style of dance, stage their own events, create their own dialect, and erect their own subculture, one that now heartily exists in nearly every country on the planet. And unlike skateboarding or other great examples of subculture that also shook up established industries, hip-hop has become unthinkably influential in so many disciplines, very much in the spirit of hacking since day one. I mean, if freaking and the paperclip payphone thing was a clever hack, well, powering record players, turntables, and amplifiers and speakers by tapping into the electricity of public light poles to have jams in a park, that sure was too. In fact, even the most basic DJ technique, the foundation to it all, was as much a clever hack as anything. You might be familiar with The Get Down on Netflix. Y'all see that? Came out about a year ago. It was essentially a recreation of the time and events and people surrounding the birth of hip-hop in the Bronx in the 70s. Some of the characters were based on real life people, including the legendary DJ Grandmaster Flash. Part of what was meticulously recreated by the show, with Flash serving as technical consultant, were the techniques and engineering prowess he brought to the game. There's a thing that DJs do manually, now you can do it with buttons and loops, but you would go back and forth on two turntables to capture this little part of the song where the beat drops and it's just the drums. And if you, 10 seconds maybe, and if you go to this turntable and you play it, and then back to this one, and then back to that, you could keep that thing going. But that wasn't a thing. Flash called it the quick mix theory. And while it's not the most complicated feat of engineering, it was incredibly revolutionary. Flash told the Washington Post, "My mother and my sister used to have house parties. What I noticed is the part of the record where there was a drum solo, the crowd would become more reactive at that point. I'm like, oh wow, why isn't this most of the record? How can I take this 10-second part that I personally thought should be the whole song and basically manually edit it and cut it and paste it on time to the beat? He says, I did extensive studies on the stylus, the needle. I had to figure out the proper needle that would stay inside the groove when it's under the pressure of the vinyl being moved counterclockwise. That was the first step. The second step was figuring out what to do with the rubber matting that comes with the turntable. When I was trying to move the vinyl counterclockwise, it caused too much drag and too much friction, so I had to remove it. None of that was the steel platter. The problem is I couldn't put the vinyl on the steel platter because then if there was a cut on the other side, I would ruin the record. My mother, he says, was a seamstress, so I knew different types of materials. When I touched felt, he says, this could possibly work. The problem is that felt draped. It was limp. So I ran home and got a copy of my album, and I cut just enough felt to cut out two round circles the size of an LP. And when my mother wasn't looking, I turned the iron on all the way up high, and I used my mother's spray starch. I sprayed it until this limp piece of felt became, I call it a wafer, like what you get in church on Easter. Today, it's called the slip mat. Then he had to find the right turntable. I tested everything from Fisher-Price to a Magnavox, he says. I went into junkyards and any stereo equipment that was being thrown out. I brought it into my bedroom and I would test it. I called it the torque theory. What was most important to me was when the platter was still and I powered it up. If it took the turntable the whole turn to go up to speed, that particular turntable had poor torque. I needed the muscle because I was going counterclockwise with the vinyl. You had to kick it back to start it up. After going through countless turntables, I was going past the store on Hunts Point in the Bronx. There was an ugly steel gray turntable in the window. I went inside and I asked the salespeople, can you take that turntable out of the window? Because I need to do a test on it. So I try, and when I rest my hand on it, the torque on this is pretty good. I stopped the platter and I powered it up. And I stopped the platter and I powered it up. This turntable came to full speed at almost a quarter of a turn. I'm like, this is the turntable I'm gonna use. He says, I came from a scientific approach. Once I came up with cueing, the proper needle, the wafer, duplicate copies of records, the mixer, which I had to rebuild, I was able to take a 10-second drum beat and make it seamlessly 10 minutes. Keeps the party hopping, and it laid the foundation for rappers. I mean, that's hardware hacking, reverse engineering, a dash of good old dumpster diving, right? Not only the engineering and physical hacking of the equipment, but that very important component of, that's not what these things are for. You ain't supposed to be doing that. Flash said, I was so excited. My best friend Mike spent the night at my house, and I woke him up at 3 a.m. and I said, Mike, you need to see this. He says, you're putting your fingers on the record. He says, I know. I know. Badassery. It's impossible to quantify how much effect Flash's pioneering work has meant to the world. While other factors and people and organizations and events absolutely had parts to play, it was the inspiration and ingenuity displayed by young Grandmaster Flash that set in motion the birth of a culture and an economy that by some accounts is worth upwards of $1 trillion. Just this month, Vice did a story that attributed 5% of Toronto's $8.8 billion tourism industry, $440 million, single-handedly to the influence that Drake brings to the city. And this is a great example of how the reach and influence and innovation of rappers stretches way past mere entertainment and what's on the radio. Billboard recently reported that Drake's brand was a huge selling point, helping bring a major tech conference to Toronto for the next 3 years, expected to bring $150 million into the city. Started from the bottom, now they're there. Thank you. Again, this all makes sense. There's no genre of music, no segment of the arts, no subculture that's found a way to innovate entire industries like hip hop. And almost always it was taking something that already existed, smacking it, flipping it, rubbing it down, hacking it up. Take the music bootleg. In the 70s with vinyl, and then the 80s in the age of cassette tapes, there was a big market for bootlegs, unofficial, mass-distributed recordings. In some cases, they were entire albums being copied and sold for less than retail, but often they were secret recordings of concerts or unreleased studio sessions, a not insignificant niche industry. The Cold Crush Brothers were one of the several upstart groups uptown looking to establish themselves as leaders in the newly burgeoning world of rap up in the Bronx, pardon me. After a bootleg recording of a highly sensationalized battle for supremacy with rivals, the Fantastic Five, went viral, as it were, the Cold Crush Brothers were positioned as a rap powerhouse in the streets and nightclubs in New York City. Noticing the effect the battle recording had on their reputation, they and others took it a step further and supplied all the taxi drivers in New York City that they could copies of their cassettes to play during their shift, ensuring all five boroughs knew who the dopest crew was. Cassettes began to get sold in earnest in and around New York, and soon they're traded and passed up and down the entire East Coast. They're sent out to people serving overseas in the military. Recognizing and capitalizing this potential not only led to their individual success and others, but would lay the foundation for the unparalleled explosion of the hip-hop mixtape industry, worth several hundreds of millions of dollars by itself, and something that the record labels didn't like too much. So along with sampling, another groundbreaking musical and technological hack that hip-hop would maximize and catapult into a massive industry, one can connect the dots between mixtapes, early P2P services like Napster and Kazaa, and eventually streaming services like iTunes and Spotify, including many lawsuits that sit at the core of intellectual property and DRM issues. But it was that early ingenuity of hip-hop artists who could not book shows, they couldn't get record deals, they couldn't get radio play, their backdoor exploits to crash an industry that didn't want them, know what to do with them, sits at the very heart of the trajectory of today's entire music industry. Drum machines, sampling, turntables, mixers, DJ controllers, headphones, MIDI, live music controllers. I know there's going to be a lot at the concert. Explosive technological advances fueled by hip-hop, birthing and influencing every popular genre of music on the planet since. And all of this was preceded by the graffiti that is as New York imagery as iconic as anything else. Here, starting it all, was the rebellious energy of young black and brown youth who had something to say, even if, as with many early taggers and writers who were bombing subway cars, even if that something was simply, hey, look, this is me, this is my name, this is my style, I fucking exist. And everyone in New York City is gonna see that. At that time, in that community, we could see how that currency was priceless. In the fashion world, an Adidas executive heard some buzz about how Run DMC's 1986 song, My Adidas, was making some kind of noise. Curious, he traveled to New York City, where the already well-established crew was performing at Madison Square Garden. The story goes that DMC takes off one of their signature sneakers, and the exec looks around to see 40,000 people all holding up their Adidas sneaker in unison. Then the beat drops. My Adidas. What followed was the first million-dollar sneaker endorsement for a non-athlete. So from the adoption of Hilfiger and Jordans and Ralph Lauren and Gucci to successful upstarts like FUBU and Cross Colors and Walkerware, Carl Kanai, Fat Farm, Rockerware, Supreme, hip-hop and related youth culture influence on the fashion world has grown the urban street market into a $300 billion industry. And these are just some of the few examples. Today, I see the next iconic story starting to grow. Bonfire Open Source Radio has an amazing future in online community radio. There are several hip-hop-oriented blockchain and crypto enterprises popping up. Nas is a pretty damn successful venture capitalist, having funded early-stage investments in Lyft, Casper, Coinbase, Ring, which just sold to Amazon for $1 billion. Hip-hop artists, activists, and are influencing politics in Senegal. Paris just opened up a multi-million dollar hip-hop culture center in the middle of the city. So we see this eternally creative culture poking its rebellious ass nose everywhere, and might expect it would be taken more seriously, especially since cash rules everything around us. But perception is a hell of a deterrent, and so hip-hop's greater influence, and in fact, greater value, continues to be overlooked. Educators who are striving to radically change the schooling system, one built on oppressive and culturally insensitive foundations, know that hip-hop is a natural tool. The stats I mentioned earlier kind of prove it, and from classrooms to counseling offices, hip-hop has helped kids learn better and deal with hardship in ways that traditional methods have failed. Using music and cultural references can not only teach purely academic subjects, but also subjects such as financial literacy, civics, how to present yourself on a job interview, coding, architecture. The key to all of this is what's commonly referred to as cultural relevancy. What education administrators, business owners, entrepreneurs all need to consider is that they don't always understand the environments, linguistics, influences, the nuances of communities they have not traditionally been welcome into their field. But if they took the time to, they would discover all the ways in which these primarily young people of color can deliver new and varied perspectives, unexpected yet brilliant ideas, and a grit that can only come from living and surviving as a marginalized person in America. that hip-hop's spirit of innovation runs in the cultural DNA of millions of people. And while we absolutely want to provide them with the same opportunity as everybody else to excel in traditional spaces, education, the job market, we also need to ensure that those traditional spaces, especially the ones who claim to care about inclusiveness and diversity and progressive thinking, really understand what that means. It means embracing hip-hop music and culture as the complex social ecosystem that it is, and not be afraid of learning more about it and about those who prescribe to it. It means reaching out into those communities, finding the upcoming leaders who can align with their values and goals, and not only bring them in under the not so often not so subtle guise of tokenism, but to embrace their role as cultural ambassadors, conduits who can reach into their own world and extract budding, untapped genius, which we've seen can grow in exponential ways, amplify that hip-hop DNA. Now, I can't speak specifically to the programming, tech, or hacking communities, but I would think that a bunch of people who are often left to their own devices, pushed to the margins of society, don't like to follow the rules, or have to break some just to get a fair shake, have an incredible history of bucking systems that are in place, creating solutions to problems those systems pretend aren't there, that might be kind of right up your alley. And though not every hardcore hip-hop head looks a certain way, I know there probably aren't too many, and certainly not enough, in rooms or in conferences like this. Now, it's understandable sometimes. Advanced STEM fields have traditionally been less accessible to young students of color in this country. Many institutionalized obstacles keep black and brown kids removed from the kind of activities and organizations other students are privileged to receive. But they're no less brilliant. So it behooves the tech community, every community, to actively encourage embracing those communities. Hip-hop is one way to quickly and efficiently close that gap. We've seen events pop up across the country exploring the intersection between hip-hop and more technical hacking and programming practices. In 2016, the MIT Scratch team and a few other organizations hosted a hip-hop and scratch coding summit with the aim to explore those relationships through a series of hands-on activities and conversations with teachers, after-school facilitators, librarians, and hip-hop educators from all across the country. Participants would engage in hip-hop-related activities like learning basic breakdance moves, then use the Scratch programming language to animate shapes on screen to mimic what they've done in real life. An ongoing hackathon event series called Hip Hop Hacks hosts similar events and workshops. A recent iteration found organically formed teams working on database projects based on song lyrics, including an interface that would return map locations based on places mentioned in rap songs. Rap mentions a lot of places. Data visualization projects abounded, including a well-known project by Matt Daniels, which sorted dozens of rap artists based on the size of their vocabulary to see who might have more than, say, Shakespeare. There were several. A workshop with Python MC and Sonic Pi, which both used the music and movement of hip-hop to teach coding to middle and high school students. One workshop was great. The goal was to apply basic coding and circuitry knowledge to flip a discardable object into a piece of music technology. They took a pizza box, aluminum foil squares, a Raspberry Pi, a laptop, some wires, and made a drum machine. Right there in the workshop. It was an amazing thing for young people to get into aspects of programming by drawing upon their natural critical thinking, problem solving, tech savvy know-how, using the music and culture they love as a vehicle. So the merging of these two worlds delivers two vital benefits to more traditional hackathon events. One, by design, it invites diversity. I've been to these events. They don't scare away the kind of folks who would be at a regular hackathon. Hell, they like hip hop too. But they absolutely are more welcoming to people, young people in particular, young people of color in particular, with similar interests, who might not have even ever considered hackathons as a welcoming place. And in that space, they shine. They excel, they experiment, they network, they hack, and they bring ideas and perspectives into the atmosphere that might never otherwise have been witnessed. And that's what I love seeing the most, this intersection of technologies or media and personalities that would normally never be expected. One personal example. For many years, I worked for an alternative weekly newspaper on Long Island. It's where I got my first real taste of alternative journalism. I was a production manager, but I started writing a bit and column, a couple album reviews. But the guys I were working with, they were doing the real work, taking down the big daily newspaper for fraudulently boosting circulation numbers, taking down crooked cops, unearthing toxic landfills permeating through residential neighborhoods, government corruption, badass. I loved it, But for a couple years, I jumped away to do some other stuff. During that time, as a hobby, I got into blogging. This is what I launched my site on, early days of WordPress. I did this for a while, then came back to the paper. They were having trouble going digital. Mainly because, well, newspapers. But other than that, they had one guy, a web designer slash programmer, doing everything from scratch. Being the self-taught and very cheap person I am, I told the boss, hey boss, you could do this with WordPress for like nothing. He was clueless, but he kind of trusted me. The web guy caught wind of that, insisted that the burgeoning content management system wasn't robust enough. After all, no news platform was using WordPress at the time. But I knew it could handle it. And sorry, programmer guy, who I kind of pushed out of a job, soon we were doing it. Now, one interesting tidbit at the time, we were asked to join the Associated Press, even though we were a weekly. It wasn't normal. We were the sixth largest in the country, though, so they kind of had to pay attention. We also wanted to have a national stories feed onto the site. So I told the AP, I said, hey, we need to feed this into a WordPress site. You guys got a plug-in or an API or something? They had nothing. They were like, nobody's ever asked us for that. No news site in America was using WordPress. I eventually hacked it together using some aggregate plugin. But the point is, about a year later, some industry article touted some division of CBS News for being the first news platform to fully embrace WordPress. All right, whatever. Anyway, long story short, the paper eventually went the way of many. Weekly to monthly, digital, only to be sold off. But our publisher had an idea to keep doing real news. He knew that by night I was a hip-hop super journalist in touch with the indie music scene in New York, a podcaster, a producer slash DJ. I do some things. He had an idea which, after hashing it out, basically boiled down to this. What if Democracy Now and Hamilton had a podcast baby? And so the Newsbeat podcast was born. We do 20-minute episodes that tackle social justice and civil liberties issues. We interview thought leaders and activists and academics. We layer it all over a musical soundtrack, and we intersperse each episode with powerful lyrics that independent rap artists construct specifically for each episode. The result is hard-hitting, investigative social justice journalism with a splash of music and dope rhymes. We've had folks like Dr. Cornel West on our podcast, Barrett Brown, who's speaking at this very conference, CIA whistleblower John Kiriakou, and many others on topics ranging from America's poverty crisis to Chelsea Manning, also going to be here, to America's perpetual war, to youth prisons, felony disenfranchisement laws. Seriously, we have rappers rapping about government crackdown on protest and dissent, or the government's war against press freedoms, or radical Caucasian extremism. As unlikely as a combination of technologies, mediums, and personnel, this concept is, we recently won Best Podcast at the 2018 New York Press Club Awards, Journalism Awards, alongside other outlets like WNYC and the New York Times. Pretty badass. But this shows once again that hip-hop can legitimately exist in any industry, any field, any discipline. That hip-hop-minded individuals, whether they be artists or just people who grew up with the knowledge that everything around them is designed to stop them from doing what they want or from being who they want to be. That these people have found ways around every impediment, every structural, institutional, purposeful set of obstacles, and time again throughout history, invented in the face of oppression. Designed in the face of despair, created in the face of Jim Crow, innovated in the face of injustice, to be brilliant in the face of brutality, to hack in the face of hate. They've created music, technologies, fashion, linguistics, and hybrids of all the above that only could have come from communities where the soundtrack of their lives is hip-hop. So if you're in a hacking community, or you're into the fight against the infringement of civil liberties, or if you're into progressive politics, or alternative journalism, or cybersecurity, or education, or fighting the corrupt powers that be, and you're not reaching into the communities that have always done this, and always with less resources, less access to education, less access to technology, less privilege, and inviting them into the fold, you're missing out on untold amounts of genius and ingenuity, and you're doing your cause a great disservice. See, my challenge to anyone in any discipline is to understand that hip-hop is not merely a form of entertainment, but a full-fledged culture, and often very different from theirs. And like any unfamiliar culture, we could be wary of it, feed into the fear-mongering aspects some of us revert to when we encounter something very unfamiliar, or stop investigating once we recognize the faults of that culture. Or take time to investigate that culture further, learn it, embrace it, respect it, and respect those within it. Ironically, hip-hop as a genre and as a culture is extremely inviting. It's extremely participatory, collaborative. In fact, by nature, many hip-hop heads are proud nerds, geeks, innovators, inventors, remixers. And keep in mind, they're going to continue to rip apart, rebuild, and reinvent everything imaginable, with or without the embrace of any industry or community. They don't care if you accept them or not. They're going to keep doing their thing until you realize they've taken over your thing and are rolling their eyes as some try to reclaim it, sometimes erasing their contributions in the process. So let's not let that happen in areas that are really quite compatible. They wouldn't mind the access and resources and establishment that the tech and programming and hacking communities already have in place. They won't mind joining forces and bringing their ideas, perspectives, and concerns to the table to improve these communities, increase the level of innovation, and continue to foster inclusivity and diversity, something many of these communities have admitted to neglecting and do want to rectify. I'm confident that any results from this mashup of lifestyles could truly be freaking amazing. That's all I got. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to put up one image that has some of the links to some of the people and organizations I talked about, and I'd love to hear from you if you have any questions. I'd love to hear from you if you don't. I don't know if that thing's working. Anybody? Anybody out there? Hi. Yeah.
Microphone's back there.
Yeah, somewhere in the aisle there.
Go ahead.
They went to sleep. Yeah. Hi.
Hi, my name is Zoe Filomeno. I'm a UN youth representative. So, interestingly enough, I actually study cognitive musical neuroscience.
Okay.
Hip-hop, I grew up with it. Like, my dad grew up in the 70s in South Bronx.
All right.
And I'm from the island of Puerto Rico.
All right.
When you talk about the engineering, something interesting that happens with the vocalization of an MC and how they natural progress with beats or outside in counterbeat.
Yeah.
If I can remember, Doom.
Okay, MF Doom.
Yeah, MF Doom. Yeah. One of the things that people don't realize in my area of study is that we look for Wagner, Mozart, Beethoven, so forth. And we went to hip hop to clarify how humans are able to find these rhythms that actually connect with the encephalic mass. Create this kind of euphoric states within neurochemicals. And interestingly enough, in my thesis, I had to actually provide evidence. One of the things that I was able to prove is that Olympic athletes were using hip hop to enhance their performance during the Winter Olympics.
Did that work out, like listening to it when they...
Especially Michael Phelps, it's actually, he does talk about it. But when it comes down to the counterculture aspect of it, it was interesting that you talked about it. And even I can tell you may do some spoken word.
No, but I used to, spit a little, so.
Yeah. I'm just excited. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. No, I think I've read something along those lines recently about the Olympians specifically. I put out a newsletter. I'll put the link up again every week. And what I try to do is, I'm from the Center for Hip Hop Advocacy. It's a nonprofit organization I started. You can go there, hiphopadvocacy.org. I encourage it. We put out a weekly newsletter. We curate stories like that. All the, cool stuff that hip hop is into. One of the other things that has been studied at some length in terms of hip hop and brain science and all that stuff is freestyle, the improvisational skills that rappers have jazz musicians are also kind of in that same vein. And I know that there's been many, many studies that have looked at how the brain is working under those circumstances. You know, control, read some rhymes that were written, and then they brainwave them when they're actually, you know, freestyling off the top of their head, impromptu. And it just, those explosion of brain activity, and it's such a complex thing. So it's, you know, as a hip-hop advocate, as someone who's into this thing, when people, you know, deride it and say that, you know, it's so simplistic, it's, you know, it's this, it's all these negative things, I'm like, you don't understand that this is really a complicated thing these people are doing. And of course, if you only have a limited aspect of, you know, limited viewpoint as to, oh, I hear what's on the radio, or I hear, you know, what the media tells you, you won't understand that there's a lot of other complex things happening up in someone's noggin, you know, when they're doing that. So, yeah, that's cool. Good stuff. Yeah.
Hello. Hi. Just a quick question. You talked a bit about the history. I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about King Tubby and Osborne Ruddock, the sound engineer, and his role in the history.
I'm not that familiar.
He's the guy who invented dubbing, apparently.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I'm not familiar with that, you know, that particular vein. But that's what we're doing here, is trying to make sure that a lot of these things have, you know, a place to live. So I'd like to look into it more and kind of get into that. If you're talking about, dubbing in what way?
As it was used in reggae.
Right. Okay. Because dubbing cassettes. You know what I mean? So I understand what you're saying. No. I'd like to. You know. I'd like to learn more, or know more, or connect those dots a little better. Just not thing I have at the top of my head.
Real quick, there's like a hour and a half documentary on King Tubby on YouTube. If you want.
Dope. Yeah.
Sure. So I just want to ask. I think you probably have a lot of people here that are from out of town, so this might be a good opportunity to tell us. If we want to go see some good hip-hop in the next few days that we're down here, where would you send us?
Wow, let's see. What day is today? Friday.
Union Square.
Well, okay. Oh, geez, wow. I mean, you going to go right now? We can go down to Union Square right now.
Yeah, we already wrote that one down.
Okay, so yeah, they'll be outside, Legendary Ciphers, every Friday night from 8 p.m. to midnight, right outside of the Union Square subway station from May to October. A bunch of MCs get around, a crowd is huge, people jump in. It's an amazing feeling. You can check, although we're not very strong, but I'll go home tonight and make sure. Birthplacemag.com is my site, the old site that covers New York area hip hop music and culture. We have a calendar on there. I don't know if there's anything really up there for tonight and tomorrow. This is there may be something. I don't know if it's happening this Sunday. There's something that's called End of the Week. It happens every, I want to say, fourth Sunday, third Sunday, fourth Sunday. Last week was really good. You guys came at the wrong week. It's like four or five things that happened in the last few days. You want to check End of the Week. That's a monthly event. There are a few monthly events. If you're here, you know, out of town and you miss something, you know, come back. It's New York City. Why are you not coming back? But there would be several monthly, I'm just going to say it for the record. I want people to know about them. Freestyle Mondays happens every month. This is actually, we talk about freestyling and impromptu. It's a battle. Right, it's on stage. They spin a wheel. It's like a game show. The topic gets chosen, and it'd be like food chain. And then there'll be two MCs, and be like, okay, flip a coin. Who goes first? All right, one of you is gonna be a fish. One of you is gonna be a newt. Go. And I'm telling you, this is not making it up. This is, it'll, and of course they'll be like, okay, one of you, it'll be politics. It'll be like, one of you is Trump and one of you is Putin. Go. And they have to battle each other, top of the head, no writtens, didn't even know that the topic was going to be, you know, assigned to them. That goes on once a month. It's called Freestyle Mondays. It's one of the best things in the world. End of the week is the, I want to say, third Sunday of the month. Freestyle Mondays happens at Pianos. End of the week happens, what's that? Huh? I won't say Bowery Electric, but End of the Week, week spelled W-E-A-K. They've also gone to other countries, End of the Week and Freestyle Mondays in France, in Czech Republic, a few other countries as well, and it's all started here in New York. These are like 17 and 15 year running series. New Eurekan Poets Cafe has a couple of monthly events as well that would have the kind of hip hop that you probably think doesn't exist anymore. Yeah.
Okay. So hip hop and politics have always had a love-hate relationship. And one, of course, the Jesse Jackson campaign where politics missed the boat. I feel like we have a time right now where we need to kind of start from the bottom up again, especially with the communities where hip hop originated. Yep. Do you have any access to organizations that are looking for something like that right now? Because I am involved with other people in a project where we're looking to get people to run on, let's say, the New York County committee level and other ways. And it's also connected with a technology and website. Mm. But it would be great to find ways to unite and to build on a newer movement in a different direction.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it's one of the, I guess, misconceptions about hip hop. And I mentioned Majesty, who I knew and you know, I was really impressed by it. And I know that he'd be at the forefront of that kind of thing. To say that, you know, hip hop doesn't really have a foot in the activist world or the political movements, you know, they'll say, well, you know, there's a couple of big artists, you know, J. Cole, he does all that stuff. Yeah, but there's a lot of community-based, you know, local, you know, Tef Poe was in Ferguson, St. Louis, Missouri area for years before, you know, the big blow up over there. And then he came to, you know, kind of, you know, he stepped up a little bit during that situation, but he was always there. So we have people that do this stuff. There are organizations that are very hip-hop minded. Dr. Bettina Love has a program called Get Free Hip-Hop Civics Ed. And this is, so you want to teach civics to kids through hip-hop and make them understand that they have to get involved or how to get involved in the political atmosphere, in local politics, in grassroots organizing. You know, they're not taught that in school. I mean, no one's taught civics class anymore. You know, but so there are organizations like Dr. Bettina Love. I think it's called Let's Get Free or Get Free Hip Hop Civics Ed. So that's one that comes to the top of my mind at the Center for Hip Hop Advocacy, which I founded. But we want to actually, that's one of the things we're working on, is actually having a sort of a go-to space for organizations that are using hip hop in these ways in different categories. Again, healthcare, you know, mental health therapy is a huge area that hip hop's finding a lot of success. Education by far. Look up the Hip Hop Ed Movement. For that as well. It's a hashtag, Hip Hop Ed. They have a Twitter chat every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. I also have a podcast that airs every Tuesday night at 10 p.m., but you can find it on your podcast app. It's called Hip Hop Can Save America. And it interviews people who do exactly these kind of things. The first guest was Dr. Bettina Love, so that's why I mentioned her. So there's definitely some research that has to be done. One of my goals with the organization is to not just come here and talk and, you know, look handsome, but I want to make sure that we have these kinds of resources available to some say, oh, I want to find out all the grassroots or local movements that intertwine with hip hop on a political scale or on a healthcare. I want to have that as a resource. So we're working on that. Anyone else?
Hey. I'm very big into the reggae music scene.
Okay.
And, dancehall and reggae are not the same thing, but most of my friends think that they are because they're not familiar with the Rastafarian versus the dancehall.
Fair enough.
Is rap and hip hop the same?
No, but it's complicated for many of the same reasons. You know, if you look at hip hop, it's sort of the overarching culture of which rap is a piece of. So the elements of hip hop, you know, the rapper, the DJ, the graffiti, the writing, the dance aspect, some would say the knowledge of self is the other element. These are kind of like, you know, the elements that are stated. So rap is basically an element of hip hop. But because, you know, record industry and music says that this is hip hop music. So you'll hear me say, and, you know, this is why I have to be very clear about it. I have to say hip hop music and culture. Or if I'm specifically talking about the music, I'll what do you do it when it's at the end? It's not a preface, it's the other one. I'll suffix it with music because I want to make sure that distinction is being made. But I think that still fools a lot of people. And it's complicated because it's the kind of the only time that like a genre has the same name, a genre of music has the same name of the culture from where it, you know, is born. So I get the confusion, but no, not the same.
Anna Taru, Tuesday Nights Podcast, Democracy Now, Nas,
yeah,
Fox Lies. All these things are all related to like progressive stuff and stuff that's mentioned on Democracy Now. So I'd like to hear more about specific artists maybe that are, you know, playing on Democracy Now and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Democracy Now! Plays, you know, has that. I know that The Intercepted always has The Intercepted podcast, or The Intercept always has a little hip hop element. Newsbeat. It's a great podcast. I'm telling you, 20-minute long episodes. We actually have local independent artists that are actually speak to a lot of these issues. There are tons. There are tons. I mean, you know, people go to the well and they'll say, well, you know, Immortal Technique and Talib Kweli, but there's a 25-year-old brother named Kemba from up in the Bronx. Used to be known as YC the Cynic. I've been following his career for a great long time. Again, Tef Poe out of Missouri. Rebel Diaz, who actually have a show on WBAI, have been, you know, talking about this kind of, has been blending music and activism for years. Not just songs, but going out and doing the work. So I like to always talk about these kind of artists as much as possible. Women artists, and let's not get it twisted, people, another thing that people think don't exist anymore. You know, you have Sarac, the MC. You know, you have so many different types of people doing different types of music. And it's like anything else. Any genre will tell you this. You got to dig for it because it's not on the radio. They're not going to put these kind of artists on the radio. They don't want to have this kind of progressive thought out there. So they're out there. You know, follow me. I talk about them a lot. Again, Newsbeat, I am plugging, but Silent Night is our artist in residence. Again, when I talk about, you know, we're giving a platform now where artists can actually speak about these subjects from an artist's perspective through their medium and not have to worry about whether it's going to be played on the radio or not. Like, so we're inviting that. Just the artists that have been on the podcast, Silent Night, a Liquid, a woman from Inwood. She's from here, she's from South Carolina, but she's from here. Rabbi Darkside, Kayem. You know, these are artists that we've featured, and so we're specifically reaching into those communities to try to get those kind of artists and give them a little bit more light as well.
There's a group in New York called North Coast.
Yeah, there is.
Improv.
Yeah, yeah.
They teach hip-hop improv. I went to one of their shows. Really liked
it. They're fantastic. So, yeah. I've interviewed North Coast. Yeah. Yeah, no, North Coast. Yeah, again, so Freestyle Mondays is live. Oh, by the way, Freestyle Mondays live band while they're doing that spinny wheel thing. It's amazing. Best band in the world. Even though it's not always the same people, but it's still always the best band. North Coast Improv is a great organization. They do great work. It's a lot of fun, and it's all improvisational stuff. It's exactly that. This is another example of, you know, what people don't think really exist. Well, you know, so thank you. Thank you for being, you know, the person who knows.
All right, so I wanted to thank you for your talk, and I'm very appreciative of it. And so, but also I want to add in, I guess, another thing to look into to add onto your presentation for the development. So,
yeah.
Another cool thing to look into would be Biota Beats, and so by this group EMW Street Bio, affiliated with MIT. Essentially, it's a microbial record player and so forth that translates bacteria into sound. It'll be really cool to look into.
Ah, that sounds amazing.
I recommend connecting with Dr. David Soon Kong from MIT's Media Lab, but also look into the community bio summit and so forth, which would be this October. And so,
oh yeah, all right, yeah, I love all that stuff. I know, like, there's got a lot of stuff happening again at the I guess the concert happening here tonight, you know, chip tunes and all this, you know, all the old, you know flipping all the old consoles to make music from it. It's just, I know it's not all hip-hop, but it's all hip-hop.
Right.
You know what I mean? So yeah,
okay, we're out of time.
We're out of time, so thank you so much. I'm very honored and privileged to be here today. Follow up many times. I'm around. Thank you.